Well, good morning and welcome to a new sermon series on the Lord's Prayer. This prayer, sometimes called the Our Father or in the Catholic Church, the Paternoster, the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples and all of us to pray. And so over the next 4 weeks, quite simply, we're going to do this reflection on what prayer means, what it looks like, walking through the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray. In particular, we're going to be looking at the way Jesus taught it as it's recorded in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 11, starting in verse 1 through 4. Let me read that for us, and we'll reflect today. Jesus was teaching in a certain place, and after he had finished, one of his disciples said to him, "Lord, teach us to pray, as John taught his disciples." He said to them, "When you pray, say, 'Father, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Give us each day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins. For we ourselves forgive everyone indebted to us. And do not bring us to the time of trial.'" Well, here we are. Lord, teach us to pray. This prayer comes from the heart of Jesus. As the disciples followed Jesus around in his ministry in Galilee, they saw miracles and exorcisms and wonderful teaching. But we see here that it was actually Jesus' prayer life that most piqued their curiosity. Jesus would take off for hours at a time, sometimes even overnight, to pray. And so the disciples asked him, "Lord, would you teach us to pray?" And so when Jesus shares this with the disciples, he's actually speaking from his own prayer life, his own heart, his own pattern of prayer and life. Jesus is teaching them and teaching us as he prayed. Now, perhaps what most surprises you as you read the passage is just how brief it is. This is probably the shortest version in the Gospel of Luke. And this prayer was too brief, I think, for Protestants who traditionally have added the doxology at the end, "The kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours." That's not in the original text. We added that later. And Luke's version, as I said, is even shorter than the one found in Matthew. 5 simple requests, 2 about God and 3 about us. And that is it. But I think it's the brevity of this prayer that is a part of its power. Simply put, these simple, brief words are packed within them, sort of like DNA, incredible information. It's not a long essay you need to remember, but a simple and portable power pack of a prayer that we can internalize and build upon. Many times a week, I ride by my club, the Winoona Bulli RSL, and you can see the 3 words out the front on the memorial: "Lest we forget." Now, on the surface, to the outside, these 3 words don't mean much. What are we not supposed to forget? What does "lest" mean? Who is the "we"? But to those who have been taught, who've been inculcated, catechized in what these words mean, when we understand that we cannot hear those words without conjuring up a whole suite of feelings and images and convictions about the sacrifices of Australians who've gone before us. And embedded in those very brief words are stories and visions of what it means to be a citizen of Australia. And I think in the same way, this is how the Lord's Prayer works as well. Small, few words that pack within them an enormous amount of information, feelings, stories, convictions. If we can allow it to shape it, shape us, praying over and over again, treasuring each phrase, nourished by each word, the Lord's Prayer can teach us to pray. When you want to go deep with God, the Lord's Prayer will lead you there. When you are lost for words, the Lord's Prayer will help you. When you are perplexed, the Lord's Prayer will comfort you. Hear this tool that we can use over and over and over again in every circumstance. So let's look at what this prayer teaches us. We'll just look at a few lines today. But firstly, I want to say that in some ways, obviously, none of us needs to be taught to pray. As human beings, I think we pray instinctively. In moments of gratitude or panic, worry or wonder, it's not uncommon for us to simply pray instinctively. Anne Lamott, a wonderful author from the Bay Area in near San Francisco, has said that the essential 3 prayers are this: help, thanks, and wow. Help, thanks, and wow. And that's true. And my guess is that each of us, whether we're Christians or not, consider ourselves prayers or not, have prayed a prayer like help, or thanks, or wow at some point in our lives. But when Jesus teaches us to pray, he's telling us that prayer is not just instinctive. There is a way to pray, a pattern of prayer that draws us deeper. Now, that's not to say that we can master prayer. It's not something that can be mastered, but we can grow in our power to pray. In the same way that it's instinctive to be in a relationship with someone else, we can also grow and become better at how we are in relationships. The same is true for prayer. It is possible to pray more and more like Jesus. So let's look at this prayer, beginning with the prayer itself. Today we look at the first two lines, Father, hallowed be your name. Now notice that the prayer begins with God and focusing on who God is. Now that seems obvious, of course, but very often, although I say the word, I skip this and jump straight to my needs. But Jesus teaches that our prayer ought to begin and dwell on who we are praying to. Firstly, we pray to a father. No other teacher in the ancient world would start with such a familiar term. I think grammarians say the original Hebrew version of this would have been a much more intimate version, not just father, but daddy. Jesus is giving us a remarkable picture of God's closeness to us. Of course, he's not saying that God is male. What he's trying to do is show us that we begin with intimacy. We are speaking to someone who is already well disposed towards us. There are many examples of bad fathers, I know, but I think we can all imagine what a good father is supposed to be. Such a father sees us, recognizes us, is eager and ready to hear from us. A father knows us, was there when we were born. A father sees himself in us and is proud of us. A father cannot be at peace while we are heartbroken and cannot be at rest while we are estranged. The child is known to the father and the father is ready to receive us. In fact, a father is longing to hear from us, excited for that text or that phone call. So already we see the affirmation of prayer that it's not a strange or an alien conversation, but a familial conversation, a heart to heart. Every dynamic in the society we live in seeks to alienate us from God, make us think about anything other than God, to make us strangers to one another. And we feel it too. Whenever I ask people to pray in the church, so often I get that phrase, oh, that's not for me, I'm not sure I could. God is just for the good people or the church people or the spiritual people or the smart people, the people who are well-spoken, the inward-looking people or the confident people, anyone but us. We feel alien to our own prayers. But if God is our Father, none of that matters. A stumbling, faltering, failing prayer is just as good as a well-spoken, articulate prayer because the heart of intimacy is already there. God sees us. His desire is for us. We can come to him. So already Jesus is teaching us how to pray just with this first word. Just by the word Father, we are breaking down the barrier between God and us. Prayer is intimate. But then Jesus takes this simple word, Father, and connects it with a phrase that might confuse us. The second phrase is probably the one that people have the most difficulty with in this prayer. The phrase, hallowed be your name. The word hallowed is not one that we use often. Maybe we might say these hallowed halls when we're talking about dignified or grand old historic places. Halloween, maybe. What does hallowed mean? Well, it's connected to the word holy, but I'm not sure that helps us all much either, because holy is not a word that we really understand a great deal either. Holy means to be set apart, to be made special, unique, set apart as the supreme value. God is the Holy One, the one who is utterly separate from the world, not just the man upstairs, not just a powerful being, but the one in whom everything was made and holds existence. There is God, and there is everything else that comes from God. When we speak to God, we're speaking to a father, yes, but we're also speaking to the one who is beyond all control and conception, God. Now, God is holy, so Jesus is not praying that God would become holy. Jesus asks us to pray that God's name would be made holy in my heart and life and in this world. That I, myself, would set apart God as my greatest good, that I would see God as God, that I would set God first above all things in my life, that the God who is would be the God that I would understand, the way God actually is in all his holiness and beauty and majesty and power, I would come to understand God in the same way. Now, this is a prayer that God would not just become one more value or interest, but that God would become the center of everything, the one who sets the agenda for everything. Simply put, that we would meet God as God. Now we see here how different this is from, certainly from my prayers. My prayers are often about me, and I ask God to support and help me. I don't take the moment to step outside of myself and say, God, you are the one who is at the center. You are the cause and the source and the goal of all life. God is our Father, yes. There is an intimate connection. God is for us, yes. But God is also the holy God to whom we owe everything. This is something that we struggle with. Now, of course, like I said, we all struggle to do it, to make God holy in our lives. But I actually think deep down it's worse than that. As 21st century people, as Australians, as educated people, as individualized Westerners, I think that this actually might be wrong or dangerous. It feels a little bit like religious extremism. We don't want to be too religious or obsessive or weird. The idea of a very holy person for us is not actually an attractive idea. God has his place, I think, but don't go too far. God is good, but don't go overboard. If I become too serious about God or make God too large in my life, I will somehow lose myself, die in a sense, die of boredom or extremism or loneliness, just somehow losing myself. The holiness of God, the godness of God, the set apartness of God is scary to us. That's why the imagery of holiness in the Bible is so often that of fire. We want to get close, but not too close, lest we be consumed. It can feel like we're losing ourselves when we approach a holy God. Can I have just a little bit of God to help me get through life, a helpful part of God, but no more? That's not what Jesus teaches, though. When he says, hallowed be your name, he's saying increase the sense of God's holiness in my life, that God would be more fully God in my life, my highest good, my deepest joy, my most centered center, the fullness of all things in my life. Now, what this doesn't mean is becoming more churchy or more religious. God is not found in church alone or religion alone, so it can't be that. In fact, the idea of the holiness of God is that God is in all things and everywhere. So it does mean, although maybe not more churchy, it does mean taking worship and prayer more seriously, to find more weight in it. And more than that, it means that in everything, I am ordering my life around God more and more. Everything that I value finds its place in the light of God, meaning that I seek God in my marriage, in my time, in my hobbies, in my job. These are all important things that find their proper place under God. I speak with God about them. I ask God about them. I consider how God might shape and transform them and me within them. And yes, in some cases, I allow God to reorder my affections, to let some things lose their value and some things increase in value. St. Augustine, that great theologian, actually talks about the challenge of being a human is not that we love the wrong things, but that we love things in the wrong order. We have disordered affections. And so what Jesus' prayer is inviting us to do is to place God at the highest and everything else to find his place far below that. Is that scary? Well, yes, yeah, certainly. I'm a minister. It's my job and it terrifies me. But then I step back for a moment. If God is not my center, my highest calling, then what is? Will it be my work, a slave of capitalism, of the paycheck? Will it be my hobbies, waiting, living for the weekend? It's a small life. Will it be somehow me making the world a better place, myself at the center? How arrogant. Will it even be my wife or my marriage or my kids? Now, they don't want or need to be the center of my world. They will shoo me out of the house soon enough if I make them the center. Or even worse, in this distracted and scattered century, we would spin around not centered on anything, but knocked this way and that by passing fads and shallow opinions and shiny objects. What a shallow existence with no center whatsoever. No, friends, Jesus teaches us that we are made for far more than these things. We are made for God. It is only God who is large enough and good enough and wise enough to center my life on. God who gives us power to work in our jobs with joy, but the joy of rest as well. God who frees us from lesser masters. God who fills our world with beautiful gifts, but uses them as signs to point to the giver himself. God who gives us that joy of love and family and friends, but frees us from being needy and depending on them for our deepest satisfaction. C.S. Lewis, amongst other mystics, say that God is like the ocean, deep and vast. And like the ocean, the immensity of God scares us. We are scared to drown, to go too deep, and so we play in the shadows, always keeping one foot on the shore. But in Jesus' teaching, in his prayer, he invites us deeper, out into the waters, to swim into their depths. God is not a burden or an obligation. God is all, the very ocean of existence. And when Jesus teaches us to pray, "Hallowed be your name in my life," he is teaching us that it is possible to learn to swim, to go deep into those depths. It is this first line of the prayer that shapes everything else, not just our prayer, but our life. The word Father invites intimacy and comfort. The word hallowed and holy invites wonder and worship. The word Father means we are safe. The word holy means we are called deeper and deeper into the beautiful and dangerous depths of the life of God, where we find our life. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.